platform for knowledge sharing of ideas and a way to ensure that scholarly activity is open to all. With that in mind, and at a recent Board of Trustees meeting, we agreed on the idea of launching a public lecture series, bringing in thought leaders to share their thoughts and their ideas and their views on areas of prime importance to us all. We want to bring in leaders from both the Armeni community and, more widely, internationally. We hope that everybody benefits from such opportunities to learn, challenge, and reflect on some of those issues that face us. I don't think that we could have chosen a subject more pressing than energy transition. Whether you're filling your car up at a petrol station or you're pumping oil in Harweel, I think we're all feeling this changing relationship with energy consumption. We're all touched by it, and given that changing economic, environmental, and society that we live in, a strategic view to addressing sustainability in the way we produce and consume energy is a must. By driving forward the energy transition and diversification journey, Oman positions itself for long-term sustainability. This is something all nations aspire to. On that note, given that I'm confident of the importance of energy transition, I'm also certain that we couldn't have chosen a more knowledgeable, engaging, and energizing speaker as we have tonight in Mr. Raoul Rastucci. Raoul has been managing director of PDO since October 2010. After receiving his degree from Nottingham University, UK, I will let you off for not choosing one of ours, but Raoul took up various posts with Shell from 1980 onwards in places including Southeast Asia, China, the Middle East, and more recently, obviously, the Gulf. We are delighted and humbled that Raoul has accepted our invitation to launch the Muscat University Public Lecture Series and share his thoughts with us tonight. Before welcoming Raoul to the stage, I would like to take this opportunity to thank colleagues both here at Muscat University and colleagues from PDO for making tonight possible. There's a lot of organization and planning and back office work that takes place, and without that, I don't think we'd have been here tonight. So thank you all very much for that. Finally, please join me in welcoming Raoul to the stage to share his thoughts.
Assalamualaikum and wa rahmatullahi and wa barakatuh. So, Dr. Yousser, Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's an absolute privilege for me to be here at the opening session. It's not clear to me whether it'll be a learning event, but I'll certainly share my views, my unbiased views, because obviously as managing director of an oil and gas company, there tends to be an element of preference towards one side of the fence. But I'll do my best to share with you key elements of the energy transition, the structural change that are taking place, and they'll significantly take place over the next few decades. And, you know, as a principal point, how we shift from a finite fossil fuel driven energy system to one that has a variety of options and alternatives, and where the increasing emphasis and focus is on energy management and energy efficiency and energy demand. So I'll try and put a bit of structure with a few notes, but you'll find me more schizophrenic than usual. So I'll start with being very bearish, and then I'll shift to being more bullish, and then I'll come back to bearish. Because at the end of the day, I want you to focus on the opportunities on both sides of the fence, because they're very, very significant. And I hope that if I succeed in anything, is to provide you comfort that there's so much opportunity on both sides. And I'll start by being very, very bearish when it comes to, say, oil. There's a very strong supply out there, and the whole world has become more efficient. From $110 a barrel in 2013 to less than half that, and a third of that just a few not long ago. The the super commodity cycle of China Inc. The booms and busts will continue, but the super commodity cycle is probably gone for some time. You see real efficiency improvements that are getting embedded into countries like China and beyond. The carbon crunch, the reality is dawning upon us. And the conversation is going from a punch-up between two scientists that have different views of whether climate change is real to an emotional and existential threat. Energy efficiency has always been part of the business, but now it's becoming core and critical to everything we do. A fourth industrial revolution and renewables are dramatically changing the way we do our business. And lastly, stranded assets. We have to continuously replenish our business, but it's increasingly more difficult to do so when the alternatives are getting more and more competitive. So I'll try and give you a flavor on some of these specific messages. The point I want to start by saying is that PDO is well positioned to weather any storm. There isn't an oil price challenge out there that we would suffer and slow down. In fact, we have done more in 2016 and 17 at $40, $50, $60 a barrel than we ever had at, when the oil price was $110 a barrel. So let's start with a few specifics. We talked about supply. So I joined Shell in 1980, and at the time some of my colleagues in mining engineering and gold mining and were saying, why are you joining the petroleum industry? It's only got one generation to go. There's only a trillion barrels of oil left. Well, after 38 years, we've produced those trillion barrels, and guess what? There's 4.5 left now. That's 150 years of oil production at today's demand. On the gas side, there's 32,000 trillion cubic feet of ultimate recoverable identified at the moment. And we've only produced 8,000. And in the early years, most of that was flared anyway. There's 200 years of gas at today's demand. So that supply is strong, no matter how you cut it. And one thing is certain, death. For some of us, taxes and technology. You can rest assured that technology will continue to find more. So the supply is strong. Don't let anyone believe otherwise. And those 4.5 trillion barrels are recoverable at today's prices. Then we talk about the fourth industrial revolution. And that is the arrival of transformation of technologies simultaneously that are dramatically improving productivity, boosting productivity like at no other time in our history. Well beyond the first, second, and third industrial revolution. Over the last 5, 10, 15 years, we've been plateauing on this S-curve with loss of productivity, disappointment in terms of the step change that the web and IT was going to deliver. But now we enter into a new S-curve, and we're at the bottom of that S-curve, and the productivity boost you'll see going forward is dramatic, and it's quite exciting. And I wish I was joining the company today as a production technology, because the opportunity is massive in what you can do with the power of advanced analytics and machine learning and robotization and business process automation and deception technology and digital twins. My gosh, it's a complete new language. But above all, it's a completely new ballgame. By the way, everything that can be digitized is electric. We'll come back onto that. Then we have the three digital printing. That's going to have massive, significant impact and actually undermines the very concept of mass production. That used to be the competitive advantage. Low labor costs was the competitive advantage. How could you compete with India and China and Southeast Asia? Now, 3D printing allows just-in-time delivery, localized, when you want it, how you want it. And so the question is, well, you know, it's about robotics and how the new production lines are dominated by these robotics. And that's very true. But robotics need what? They need power. And the Far East will be importing a lot of that power. It doesn't have the indigenous supply. So the competitive advantage they have now versus perhaps the lower competitiveness and the higher cost structure that Oman has can actually be repositioned with the fourth industrial revolution, where we simply leapfrog because the supply side of power here is infinite. And we'll come back onto that. Cars. They're moving from molecules to electrons. We've seen an exponential rise of electric vehicles. In London, as of 1st of January this year, all London cabs are electric. We've seen major statements by China, by India, by most European countries that they'll ban ICEs, internal combustion engines, by 2030. France and UK have said 2040. That was some of the first to come out, so I'm sure they'll quickly revise that to 2030 and beyond. Volvo is not going to issue any more cars or produce any more cars which are not hybrids and electrical by 2021, I think. Major stakes in the ground, serious stuff. So what does that mean for oil in terms of the demand? And again, don't forget, I'm wearing the bearish hat at the moment. Well, the transportation side, light vehicles will be hit, but aviation, petrochemical, will continue to rise. Unless petrochemicals are challenged. I mean, look at the challenge across the world on plastics, which are a key product of petrochemicals and its derivatives. There's a real momentum. This is not something that's going to fade away. What if, I don't know, graphene, which is a simple layer of carbon atoms, incredibly conductive, very robust, very light, very flexible, becomes an off-the-shelf available technology or commodity and replaces plastics, or maybe another material? Then what happens to petrochemicals? Because that's a capital-intensive industry. And that would be quite challenging. So, stranded assets. I mean, the challenge is, as the environment with alternatives, solar, wind, or otherwise, are becoming more and more competitive, how do you place the big bets? Because our business is getting tougher. We're going from the easy oil to the more difficult oil. Plenty of reserves there, but it requires more capital intensity, from primary to secondary to tertiary. Primary, natural flow, secondary, you add water injection, gas injection to provide sweep and efficiency and pressure, and tertiary is you change the physical, you know, constituents of oil, you make it lighter through steam, or miscible with high pressure gas, like adding carbon CO2 on a Coke, plenty of energy. So how do you place the big bets for increasingly more difficult oil? When the environment is getting more challenging, when the supply is strong, the demand doesn't necessarily increase as much as you expect. And guess what? The IMF issued a paper last year projecting that by 2040, oil prices will be $15 a barrel, 2015 real term. Now, I'm not here to speculate on oil prices, but against that environment, which will have its ups and downs, no doubt some more peaking of oil prices sooner or later, depending on which side of the bed Trump gets out of. We want to imagine that, you know, asset values could potentially decline. Selling oil today is going to be a lot better than selling it tomorrow. It's what the traders call a backwardated market, You know, prices today at a premium to tomorrow's forward prices. And all of a sudden, getting alignment at OPEC or any other level becomes more difficult. And of course, everybody just has to produce to maximize its value. Don't forget, we didn't move away from the Stone Age because we ran out of stones. So try and picture that analogy. Climate change. What I've said on demand, what I've said on prices, pales to complete insignificance against the existential threat of decarbonization. That is a key challenge. The world recognizes, the world bar Trump, including Nicaragua and Syria, signed in November and December. So now the USA are the only country that are outside the Paris Agreement. The world recognizes that it has to drastically reduce carbon emissions. The Paris Agreement is very clear about that if we want to stay below the 2-degree temperature rise, above which things would get very difficult across the world. That's the real commitment. But it's not easy. So if you look at the 13th goal of the UN Sustainable Development Commitment, it says the world has to act urgently to address climate change and its impacts. On the other hand, if you look at development goal number 7, it says the world has to provide energy, reliable, affordable, accessible to as many as possible across the world. Many of the other goals are linked directly or indirectly to energy, whether it's to reduce poverty, to increase social, medical care, and so forth. So how do you reconcile the two? And it's not an easy challenge. And as a final, wearing the bearish hat comment, many that challenge the oil business will say, you're going to compete with somebody, some new energy form that is impossible to compete against. And you say, what do you mean by that? Yeah, we know costs are going down, but it's more than that. When you look at a typical solar, wind, alternative, renewable project, it's predominantly dominated by upfront investment and a long-term power purchasing agreement, fixed. You know what you're getting into. Increasingly lower cost. But actually, when you remove the financing, you tend to forget the sunk costs. Going forward, it's free. In a zero carbon world, the marginal rate is zero. If you look at oil prices, wholesale electricity markets, that determine by the variable marginal rate. Not for renewables. And you say, well, Brown, what are you talking about? Well, let me give you a simple analogy with broadband. You buy the router, then you pay the subscription. And hopefully the service company delivers on promise. But if you use one byte or 100 terabytes, there's no cost to it. So you've turned the world of consumption completely upside down. You actually want to maximize consumption because there's, you know, zero carbon dilemma. And so you create more value, more growth, more opportunity, more expansion through a renewables opportunity, which has no cost going forward, or very, very low costs, than you do with a conventional energy alternative. So that was a bearish outlook. And if you're a student getting ready to get into the oil business, say, whoa, maybe I should reconsider the, you know, the program and get onto the renewable side. And I would say, well, hang on a minute. Because the reality is that oil, gas, and unfortunately coal will continue to play a role throughout the century. Why? So, population is 7.6 billion, and by 2050 it goes up to 9.6 billion. 11 billion by 2100. 11 billion by 2100. 20% of the energy we use today, 20% of the world's population uses 50% of today's energy, which means the remaining 80% of the population use a fraction of everybody else's. Typical consumption levels in the GCC states, which are amongst the highest, or in the Western, more affluent countries, varies between 150 and 300 gigajoules per person per annum. Developing, emerging, poorer countries are in the 20 gigajoules, some at 50. And of course, they deserve the same standards as everybody else. A billion, 1.1 billion, do not have access to a light bulb. Another billion have intermittent access to water and electricity. And so the world really has to provide and raise those standards. And so if you take an average of energy efficiency and high-consuming countries, GCC for instance, the intensity for desalination of water is enormous. Just bear in mind the simple statistics. The general consumption of water in the Middle East is 5 times higher than in Europe. Okay, but the energy intensity used to create 1 liter of water is 5 times higher than in Europe. That's a ratio of 25. 25. Now, when gas is $1 per million BTU, fine. When Dubai had to pay $17 for spot LNG delivery in 2013, that's a crisis. And guess what? What happens a few weeks later? Nuclear. And they've gone after it. Otherwise, you know, if the outlook is the prices are that high, it's just a huge, huge burden. So, you know, we've talked about, that's the first page. Consumption continues to be very, very significant. Now let's talk about replenishing production. Typical oil field declines by 5% per annum, and that's after a lot of infill and workover optimization opportunities. Typically 5%. It doesn't sound much. But by 2040, that means we need 6 more Saudi Arabias. So the amount of activity, the key message I want to leave behind is that the amount of activity is going to be incredibly high in the oil and gas business, just to meet demand. And whether we're able to replace as much as that oil, coal, and gas over the next 50 to 100 years, the level of energy that's required from conventional resources continues to be very high. I can see PDO being incredibly active for as long as I can see. And the important thing is that, yes, the environment, the pricing may be very challenged, but PDO are positioned to take on whatever prices the market throws at it. Now let's talk about, from a bullish hat, electric vehicles. So I think for every point I've raised on one side of the fence, I'm going to try and counter it on the other. Sales are about 1% of cars sold around the world. It's incredible success. Very exciting. By 2025, the projections with the most aggressive exponential rise is that they'll go to 10%. And 35%, more than a third, more than 1 in 3, by 2035. Okay, sounds great, but hang on, by 2035, when you take the whole fleet, they only represent 20%. So internal combustion engines, the conventional stuff, will continue to rise even with all this switching. So there'll be more ICE cars in 2035 than there are today. You're going to see a lot of transfer in the electrical vehicle side for light vehicles, perhaps SUVs, but it'll become more complex, far more complex in marine and certainly in aviation. And I've no doubt that in 2, 3, 4, 5 years' time, you'll have a taxi drone in Dubai, but it's going to take a lot longer than that to replace an A380 going from London to Hong Kong, that's for sure. And so that element remains very, very strong. It can only be supplied through the conventional fuels as we have today. When you take all the assumptions into consideration, you go from a world demand of 91 million barrels of oil, roughly today, to 104, 105, and potentially much more by 2040. So demand continues to rise. But how can that be? Because that's inconsistent to the Paris Agreement. So we're saying more energy is required. Much of it's going to happen, have to happen from conventional fuels. But then if we do that, we can't meet the Paris Agreement. How do we deal with that? And in each component, you can challenge so many assumptions. For instance, we've talked about the growth in electrical vehicles, but have any of you tried to figure out how much mining of cobalt, nickel, manganese will be required to meet the battery requirements? Or you can wear a bullish hat and say, no, hang on a minute, Tesla going to recycle a lot of these batteries, so it's less of an issue. And lithium, there's so much lithium, which is not a mining business anyway, it's more of an extraction from brines. So you can argue whichever case you want, but I think the fundamental principles are that, one, a lot of energy is required. And it's unlikely that alternatives will be able to meet that global demand. Two, that no matter how fast the alternatives go, how are we going to meet the Paris Agreement? Because in my personal honest opinion, the emotional side of, you know, disastrous cataclysmic weather patterns that destroy an island, a city or otherwise, will increasingly take center stage. And I think in the same way as in the 1970s with demonstrations of the fuel pumps, we could see in the next 5-10 years demonstrations of the fuel pumps, but very much focused on climate change rather than what's inside the tank. The question is, you know, do we have to make a choice? Are you bearish or bullish? Do we focus on the vicious downward circles? I think, you know, we can, we must, we need to get involved on both sides and play a key role. So let's talk about renewable energy. Final energy demand for electricity is about 20%. And ideally, everything that can be digitized can be electrified. So how do we raise that? The renewables are getting more competitive. The Energy Transition Commission believes that all hands on deck, we could achieve 50% of the entire energy system delivered through electricity. That's a massive, formidable task, but let's assume that. So what happens to the other 50%? Well, we've talked about transportation, the big, heavy freight, marine aviation will need the conventional, some will be for heating, but a big proportion, the bulk of the proportion of that non-electrified energy is to drive processes that need huge energy intensity, producing cement, smelting irons, hydrocracking petroleum. You need high energy intensity, replace it with electronics and electrical supply at this stage. So that remains embedded in the system. Solar is becoming more and more and more competitive, but it's still intermittent. I'm not sure if I'm wearing the bearish or bullish hat at the moment. Still intermittent. Residential costs are still very high. They have to come down. Battery costs are still too high. $200 per kilowatt. They have to come down to at least 100. But it's going to happen. 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, it will happen. And of course, gas is an incredible enabler to the transition. This is something that Oman is very well endowed with. In the UK, gas has replaced coal. And in fact, they've seen a step change in the greenhouse emissions thanks to that. So every coal plant, and of course, my mining engineering friends were saying, what are you doing going into the oil business? Well, they haven't got a job now. Every coal plant in the UK is closed. What did I say before? We didn't move away from the Stone Age because we ran out of stones. We're certainly not moving out of coal because we ran out of coal, because there's loads of coal. So it goes back to the stranded assets. Just because you have huge reserves of oil, don't assume you can monetize that. Don't assume you can monetize that. And the day the Venezuelans realize that they've got enormous wealth, but much of it they won't be able to monetize, maybe too late to focus on alternatives. How do you drive change? How do you drive behaviors? Well, it's going to require incredible coordinated alignment by governments to drive carbon pricing. And you'll see that more and more and more. Several states in the US have already had it in place, and they're driving dramatic change. See what's happening in California. It's also going to need a focus on removing subsidies. You have subsidies for water and electricity, and the impact that has on the cost and the unsustainable burden and cost that provides. The impact of removing the subsidies from the high-grade gasoline in Oman has dramatically arrested what was an unsustainable escalation in demand, but also an unsustainable cost to support. If you're going to support something, support medical, don't support the end products that you can't afford. It's also about personal choices. 3 minutes. Right, I'll go fast. It's also about personal choices. So it's about embracing change, not about saying it's his issue. It's about what can each and everyone do about this. And I'll give you a simple example. At home, I installed a smart thermostat in the UK. My home is, at the moment, it's very, very cold. When I'm not there, it's still heating the home, even if I program timers and so forth. Now it's geofenced with where I am, where my family are, where my kids are. So as I approach the home, the temperature goes up. As I leave the home, the temperature comes down. When I land at Heathrow Airport, the water heater starts up. So when I get home, I have a hot shower. But otherwise, it's not running all the time. I paid 100 riyals, and I saved 68 riyals in the first quarter of electricity bills. Just think if you use a simple technology like that for your air conditioning. You could geofence even the house, where you say, I'll move into this room and it'll come out. I'll go out of this room, it'll come down. That will save 15% of energy. So I've given you different perspectives, and now it's about where do we position, and I'll need 3 or 4 minutes, but where do you position Oman in that scale of challenges? You want to start with PDO. Last year, we had 500 million kilometers without a road safety accident. Geomatics delivered 36 years without LTI incident. We had 0.2 LTIs, lost time incidents, per million man hours, which is the lowest on our record. We drilled 2.7 Burj Khalifas into the ground in terms of cement and steel. You don't see them, but trust me, they're there. We had 21,500 activities to run production operations. We made huge progress in our mega projects, the most complex, the most largest projects we've ever undertaken in Rabab Ahwil and in Diba Khuf. We inaugurated the solar steam project. We expanded, are in the process of further expanding, the Nimr water treatment. not only a CR fund, but actually it's all about good business. We created 14,146 jobs outside of PDL. And that's great, but it's not good enough. If you assume an environment that will fluctuate and peak up and down, but where low prices are probably going to be fairly constrained, we have to do more. We have to create new value streams. And so we've engaged with the board and said, we can go outside our remit of Block 6 concession and help with PDO Services, PDO International, and EDO, Energy Development Oman, become a fully fledged energy company to play on both sides of the fence because there's enormous opportunity. We are successful today, but we don't want to be the Kodak of yesteryear, 20 years down the road. So how do we position to maximize and align the huge opportunities? Oil and gas activity will continue to be very, very active. But there's enormous space. Initially, less on margins, less on value streams, but a huge opportunity in job creation. Oman is endowed, is blessed to be one of the best places for the highest radiation intensity for solar throughout the year across the world. It has a maritime history of sailing, the global regional nomads. And that is a huge source of energy for the southern coast. So wind is extremely well positioned also here. How do we take that business? So this is not about being bearish or bullish. This is about being quite excited, not getting into vicious circles, focusing on that radiating possibilities of actually being involved on both sides of the equation, playing a key role as the environment around us is transforming. So wind, 15 megawatt units, are coming down at $20 per megawatt hour. Dubai, $2.99. Abu Dhabi, $2.65. Chile, $2.56. These are already competitive against gas today. And IRENA, International Renewable Energy Association in Abu Dhabi, reckons that between now and 2025, there'll be a further 50 to 60% reduction in those costs. So it's a fantastic opportunity. Now, Dubai, Abu Dhabi, Kuwait, Jordan, Morocco, Saudi have enormous plans, stakes in the ground on the renewable front. But guess what? Nobody's focusing on the local supply chain. And we're good at that. We've demonstrated in PDO through ICV and through many organizations here, we can play a key role to essentially get a key stake in what is a $200 billion business over the next 5 years that will create 200,000 jobs. We want a piece of that. And so that's the opportunity that we have. So I could take you through the fourth industrial revolution, the steps change that's creating the opportunity that provides. But I just want to summarize that I'm incredibly excited and privileged to be here in Oman at a time when times are difficult, but we have a set of opportunities that create so much scope, so much job creation, so much efficiency that we're really excited to be a part of players and contribute to that story. Thank you very much.